afternoon. The first portfolio this afternoon is Rural Affairs and Islands. If a member wishes to request a supplementary question, they should press their request to speak button or enter the letters RTS in the chat function during the relevant question. Again, I would call for succinct questions and answers in order to be able to get in as many members as possible. I call question number one, Fiona Hislop.
To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the potential impact on Scotland's agriculture sector of the UK Government's upcoming new regulations regarding meat exports.
Cabinet Secretary Mary Goujon.
The Scottish Government's assessment is that the European Union's requirement for meat to come from farms subject to regular veterinary visits will affect mainly the non-farm assured livestock sectors, but it is going to create bureaucracy across the industry that would have been unnecessary had the UK Government chosen a closer relationship with the EU based on shared standards. The vast majority of cattle, sheep and pigs produced in Scotland are farm assured. The Scottish Government is working with DEFRA to try and find a pragmatic solution that will allow farmers and the meat industry to continue exporting and minimise trade barriers. And I have raised this issue with the UK Secretary of State, Therese Coffey, to urge a speedy solution.
Fiona Hislop.
The results of the Quality Meat Scotland's annual export survey underlines the importance of European markets to those who produce Scotland's world-class meat. And the Scottish Association of Meat Wholesalers have been clear in its concerns that businesses, and I quote, stand to lose millions of pounds of export business unless DEFRA relent. The UK Government has already forced Brexit on Scotland's farmers and producers. They should be looking to make things easier, not harder. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, in the engagement she's had with the Minister, as Secretary of State, has she had any other information as to whether DEFRA are likely to amend this problematic set of regulations?
Cabinet Secretary.
Firstly, just to state, I mean, I'm absolutely aware of the concerns that the industry have. They've contacted me directly about this. And just to highlight how stark the situation is that they're facing, I fully agree with the member that it's the UK government's approach to this and to withdrawal from the EU that have caused these burdens for Scottish farmers and for Scottish businesses too. As I said in my initial response, I have raised this with the Secretary of State, Therese Coffey, at the interministerial group that we had just at the start of this week. And the officials led by the Chief Veterinary Officer are working with DEFRA to develop a workable solution. So I do hope that that is still possible. But I think it's also important just to highlight at this point as well just how proud we can be of our own Scottish producers too, because the vast majority of Scottish farms do belong to an assurance scheme, such as with QMS, which the member has raised as well. And I think it's quite right that we celebrate that too.
Supplementary, Jim Fairley.
Thank you, President Officer. We are right in the middle of lamb and calf store sale season right now, where prices are linked to what fat producers believe the longer-term values will be. The timing of this decision could be hugely damaging to hill and upland farmers, the very ones who need more support than any, and I know firsthand the stresses that this will be causing and the impact it could have. So can the Cabinet Secretary tell the Chamber if she was given any notification of this change by DEFRA or the UK Government, and if not, does she agree with me that on issues of such grave importance to our livestock and meat sector, that they have a duty to consult the devolved legislators?
Cabinet Secretary.
In relation to the member's question about the consultation, from what I understand, DEFRA had said that they'd engaged with stakeholders, but we certainly weren't involved in any formal consultation in relation to this until the most recent discussions that had taken place with the Chief Veterinary Officer. And I think, given the impact of decisions like this, of course, we should be involved in that decision making and should be consulted at as early a stage as possible.
Question number two, Russell Findlay.
Thank you, President Officer. To ask the Scottish Government for an update on the action the Scottish Government is taking to withhold farming payments from convicted criminals.
Cabinet Secretary.
There is no provision within the current legislation governing the basic payment scheme to recover or withhold payments to an individual business if they are meeting the scheme requirements. We are, however, considering whether future changes to legislation could introduce provisions to withhold payments to those who may not be fit and proper persons.
Russell Findlay.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary will probably be aware. The reason I ask is that in July, a farmer who was jailed for the sexual abuse of three children had been awarded almost £50,000 in subsidies by the SNP government. At the time, a government spokesman indicated they were considering if the law could be changed to block such payments in future, as has been repeated today. But weeks later, the Daily Record revealed that the same individual was given another £36,000. So can the Cabinet Secretary give any indication as to when this loophole might be closed?
Cabinet Secretary.
The member does raise a really important point here, but I think it is really also critical to highlight that we don't have, well, with the basic payment scheme and the powers over that are devolved, and we do have the powers to change the eligibility at the moment. We can only do that where it would simplify or improve the existing rules. So within the current powers that we have and the legislation that we have in place at the moment, it's not possible for us to do that. But as no doubt the member will be aware, we have a consultation that's open right now on future legislation that we're looking to introduce to the Parliament. So I very much hope he'll take part in that consultation and make his views on this known. And of course, we will give that consideration when we bring forward this legislation.
Question number three, John Mason.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what information it has on whether there are households that took on a pet during the COVID-19 pandemic and are now struggling to look after them in light of the cost of living crisis.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government does not hold data relating to pets purchased during the pandemic and whose owners may now be facing difficulties with providing adequate care for their pets as a result of the crisis. The Scottish Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals reports, though, that the number of calls received from concerned pet owners has increased by 218% compared to just last year. Concerned owners looking for help and advice can contact the Scottish SPCA in confidence via their helpline, and I think it's really important that if they feel they need that help, they do so. The helpline number is 03000 999 999, or they can also visit the Scottish SPCA's website to find out more about their pet aid scheme that can help pet owners with essential food supplies.
John Mason.
Yeah, I thank the Cabinet Secretary very much for that detailed answer. And as she says, some of the figures are stark. I think the SSPCA reports that in the whole of last year, there was 194 dogs taken into care. And in the first 6 months of this year, it has been around 700. So, can she encourage or give advice to pet owners? Because clearly it's better if they do not have to hand over their animals to charities. But where else they can get food for their animals, for example, at food banks.
Cabinet Secretary.
I think it is really, first of all, distressing to hear the figures that the member raises there. And of course, I think it's really upsetting when anyone feels like they're in a position where they think they've got no other option than to give up a pet that, of course, is part of their family too. And that's where I would just absolutely encourage anyone who's experiencing difficulties or think that they can't cope or keep their animal to reach out for support, because there are people there that can help. And I would like to specifically highlight the Pet Aid Initiative being run by the Scottish SPCA to support people and pets who are struggling, because I recently met with them in my own constituency to hear more about the initiative. And that's really through Pet Aid, they're supplying pet supplies and food through food banks and community larders. I know that they have it in a number of locations throughout Scotland at the moment, and they're also looking to expand that network further. The SSPCA, of course, don't want people to be separated from their pets. And I think it's really awful, and it was really awful at the time when I met with them, to hear about some of the instances where people have been effectively starving themselves to try and feed their animals. And I don't think that should be a choice that anyone has to make. The Scottish SPCA does provide invaluable support and assistance. And as I'd highlighted in my initial response, they can be contacted by phone or via their website. So again, if anyone is struggling, I would encourage them to reach out and ask for that help and support.
Supplementary, Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I'd also like to highlight the work that Edinburgh Dog and Cat Home do in terms of providing support. But during lockdown, increased demand for dogs saw increased prices, resulting in dog abductions surging a staggering 170%, according to one charity. The current law doesn't do a good job of tackling the problem. The data is poor. The maximum punishment doesn't fit the crime, and dogs are treated as objects instead of living beings. So does the Cabinet Secretary agree that we need much better options to tackle this heartless crime, such as my new dog abduction bill?
Cabinet Secretary.
That's where I appreciate the bill that the member is bringing forward, and I'm of course more than happy to discuss that with him in more detail. Now, we know that courts already will take into the account of the circumstances of any theft when they're sentencing, and including if a loved family pet has been stolen. But of course, dogs and other pets aren't the same as inanimate objects, and I know that when a theft of a pet occurs, it can of course cause significant upset to those involved. But we know that microchipping is an effective method to identify animals, and that can help reunite dogs with their owners where a dog has been lost or stolen. And this government made it compulsory for all dogs to be microchipped and for contact details to be kept up to date. And I would encourage all dog owners to ensure their dogs are microchipped. I appreciate what the member is looking to do here, though, and as I said in the first part of my response, I'm more than happy to consider these proposals when they come forward and to discuss this further with him.
Question number four, Co-Cab Stewart.
To ask the Scottish Government what its latest assessment is of the impact of Brexit on Scotland's food and drink sector.
Cabinet Secretary.
As a result of the UK Government's reckless approach to EU negotiations, Scotland's food and drink sector lost many of the benefits they once had when trading with the EU. The full economic consequences of exiting the EU are still to be realised. However, businesses now face additional expense when trading, and some food producers have found that their goods can no longer be exported to the EU. Many of Scotland's food industries are still suffering from lower exports to the EU, including a 52% fall in exports of fruit and vegetables, and there's been a 25% fall in exports of dairy and eggs in the first months of this year compared to the same period in 2019.
Co-Cab Stewart.
I'm thankful for that answer. Dr. Liz Cameron of the Scottish Chambers of Commerce recently stated that Scottish exporters are telling us that they continue to face growing challenges trading with countries in the EU post-Brexit. Given the absence of any meaningful effort to alleviate the impact on Scottish businesses of the UK government's economically inept and ideologically driven Brexit policy, can I ask the Cabinet Secretary whether she thinks issues of competence or a thinly veiled contempt for Scotland drives UK government decision-making on these issues?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think it is really disappointing when we look at the series of decisions that have been taken and really the catastrophic impact that they continue to have on Scotland and on our businesses too. We can see that in the figures that I've outlined in relation to our exports, but we also continue to see the damage of that when we consider, for example, our workforce and the labour shortages that we're seeing right across our food and drink industry, as well as across many other sectors in Scotland.
Question number five, Colin Smith.
Thank you, President Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when it will publish the outcome of both the statutory review of snaring and its additional review, which we consider a potential ban on snaring in Scotland.
Minister Mary McCallum.
Presiding Officer, we published the outcome of the statutory review on snaring earlier this year on the 1st of April, and it can be found on the Scottish Government webpages. As Mr Smith mentioned, I commissioned a review on the animal welfare aspects of snaring and also the implications of a ban on snaring and what that would do to land management activities in Scotland. I expect to be able to publish the findings of this review soon, including any decisions made regarding the future of snaring in Scotland.
Colin Smith.
I thank the Minister for that answer, although the recommendations of the review that was published in April do seem to implement the recommendations of the previous review in 2017 that haven't yet happened. So I do hope they'll be delivered this time. But can the Minister give a clear assurance that should there be any proposed legislative changes arising from the wider review of snaring, which of course I hope is a full ban, will the timescale for publishing the review and any necessary consultation allow any proposed changes to be incorporated in the Wildlife Management Grouse Bill, which is clearly the obvious place for them, rather than having to wait for separate legislation in the future?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I'm happy to confirm that should my decision be that legislative change is needed as a result of the review, that will correlate with the Wildlife Bill and be included therein.
And supplementary, Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Nature Scotland
predict that the capercaillie will become extinct in the next 2 to 3 decades, and the British Trust for Ornithology notes that the curlew populations have been rapidly declining over the last 2 decades. Predation by species such as fox is one of the foremost challenges faced by these rare birds. Yeah. So can I ask the Minister how she intends to confront biodiversity loss and protect species like the capercaillie and the curlew while her government systematically dismantles the tools such as snaring for ethical predator control?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I understand why on the one hand many people feel that snaring is, they instinctively feel that it's cruel. However, I also understand on the other hand that land managers require access to control methods for legitimate purposes, including conservation, as Rachel Hamilton says. It's exactly those considerations why I commissioned the review, and as I said to Mr Smith, I'll consider the outcome and publish it shortly.
And supplementary, Christine Graham.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Cabinet Minister, on 25th November 2021, in answer to my colleague Colin Smith, in your ministerial role, you indicated the Scottish Government would extend the scope of the snaring review to include a potential outright ban on snaring in Scotland. Can I just double check? Is that still on the cards?
Minister.
Yes, it is, Presiding Officer. The statutory review is one that is statutorily required to take place every, I think it's 5 years, although I might be getting that number of years wrong. I commissioned that separate review that Christine Graham refers to, which went beyond the terms of the statutory review and would look at the potential and the impacts of banning snaring in Scotland. And that's the review which I'll hope to publish soon.
Question number 6, not large. Question number 7, Jackie Bailey.
To ask the Scottish Government what further financial support it will provide to Argyll and Bute to help tackle depopulation of rural areas and islands.
Cabinet Secretary.
Despite our capital allocations being significantly restrained as a result of the UK Government's own spending review, we continue to invest in our rural and island communities. This investment is provided through a range of programmes such as the Affordable Housing Supply Programme, our Rural and Islands Communities into Action Fund and the Argyll and Bute Growth Deal. However, it is crucial that we acknowledge that the Scottish Government alone cannot tackle the critical challenge of depopulation. National government, local government, third community and private sectors all have a role to play if we are to collectively tackle depopulation.
Jackie Bailey.
The Cabinet Secretary will be aware that Argyll and Bute is indeed the second largest local authority by area in Scotland, but it is suffering from significant depopulation. Whilst the population increased across Scotland, it decreased in the same time in Argyll and Bute, most notably by 34% in the 25 to 44 age group. There are two infrastructure constraints. The first is the lack of a reliable service from ferries, and the second is the ongoing problem at the A83 at the Rest and Be Thankful. In the latter case, can the Cabinet Secretary tell me when a medium and long-term solution will be found for the A83, and has the funding for this been identified in the budget?
Cabinet Secretary.
These are questions that, of course, I would be happy to raise with the Transport Minister if the member hasn't already done that directly. But I think I would come back to the initial part of my response to the member in relation to the fact that we recognise that when it comes to the challenges of depopulation, it's not something that we can fix alone. It also takes work on a variety of fronts to tackle the sheer scale of the challenges that we know we've got, whether that's transport infrastructure, digital infrastructure and addressing housing. But I would also emphasise that I'm part of a ministerial task force that's looking at this. We're also going to be bringing forward a depopulation action plan, which I am leading on elements of that alongside my ministerial colleagues as well. We are intent on trying to tackle these issues in around all these problems and doing what we can across the piece as well as across other parts of government too.
I call by way of supplementary for supplementary Beatrice Wishart, but I do flag up to Ms Wishart what the question is actually about, which is what further financial support it will provide to Argyll and Bute to help tackle depopulation of rural areas and islands. Ms Wishart.
In addition to Argyll and Bute, other areas are experiencing population decline. In Shetland, we've seen that infrastructure such as fixed links has proved positive in reversing depopulation. So what additional financial support can the Scottish Government provide island areas for tunnel or fixed link infrastructure to help tackle depopulation?
Thank you, Ms Wishart. Very deftly done. And, you know, I do feel it's always important to bring questions back to the actual supplementaries back to the question on the business bulletin. But Minister, Cabinet Secretary, I'll leave the
question
to your good self.
I would again just highlight and come back to my first response to Jackie Bailey's question when I mentioned there the significant capital restraints that we're facing in relation to our budget as well. But again, that's where working across government, working with the third sector, working with local government is really important in terms of tackling all these issues that I know communities on our islands also face.
And supplementary, Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Representing Argyll and Bute, I think it's important to recognise that the HIE's business panel survey noted that 53% of businesses felt that workforce challenges were a perceived risk to their viability. Migration has a critical role to play in tackling population and workforce challenges, and sadly, Labour are now actively engaging in a race to the bottom on immigration. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that the need has never been clearer that Scotland must have its own immigration system to meet the needs of our rural and island communities, including Argyll and Bute, to reflect our values and repair the damage of Brexit?
Cabinet Secretary.
Absolutely. Migration is a crucial part of the required approach to addressing our population challenges. And we know that the UK government immigration policy does not reflect the needs of Scotland's rural communities. And that's exactly why we brought forward the rural visa pilot proposal. This is a bespoke approach, and it's not just something that we've developed and delivered ourselves. We've worked on that, and it's been supported by a range of partners, including through our local authorities. And I know that Shetland Islands Council, for example, have previously commented that they consider this to be an extremely important step when it comes to addressing the demographic challenges and skills shortages, which simply have to be counted among the most serious issues facing our economy. And I would also add as well, and I know that members sitting around the chamber today will already be aware of this, that the rural visa pilot proposal was endorsed by a clear majority in the Scottish Parliament during the parliamentary debate that we had on that topic in September. And that's where I would strongly encourage the UK government to be more receptive to the democratic will of this parliament and to allow this proposal to go ahead.
Question number 8, Edward Mountain.
And I refer members to my register of interest. Having attended the statement yesterday, I think I know the answer to this question, to ask the Scottish Government whether its proposed new agriculture bill will be introduced before 2024.
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes.
Edward Bynt.
Oh, well, that was predictable. Let's see if we can get a yes or no answer for this question, then, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary yesterday failed miserably to answer my question on whether farmers were going to be any more aware of the conditionality of future farm support. Cabinet Secretary, forever the optimist, I want to try again. Can you confirm all farmers will have access to all the agri-support schemes that replace the single farm payment, and they will not be excluded by their location or land type? A yes or no answer, Presiding Officer, would suit me.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, first of all, I would say that my initial response was only predictable, again, because you were here for the parliamentary statement yesterday, and I'd already committed to introducing the Agriculture Bill to Parliament next year. And again, I would come back to the fact that what I'd outlined yesterday in relation to what we're bringing forward in 2025 is a rollover of the schemes that we have at the moment. And just to make crystal clear, we want the enhanced payment when that is introduced, and that's the first element of the new framework that we'd be looking to introduce, that would be available for everyone. And that's why we're working with our stakeholders to produce the appropriate measures for that payment through our national test programme, Testing Actions for Sustainable Farming. Now, we know that many farmers and crofters have already been leading the way, and it's only right and fair that that work is recognised, as I outlined yesterday. And the enhanced payment won't only seek to recognise and reward those people who have been pioneering that work, but it also aims to support and incentivise the continued efforts of others too. So that's where I would again strongly encourage all farmers and crofters to join the national test programme, which is testing the actions which could form part of that enhanced payment to ensure that this is developed in a way that is accessible for everyone.
Supplementary, Liam MacArthur.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary will be aware of the importance of livestock farming in Orkney and will also be aware of the growing concern about the fall in suckler cow numbers in the islands. What assurances, therefore, can she offer that the Agriculture Bill will actively support retaining the critical mass of the Orkney beef herd and help build desperately needed confidence within the wider farming sector in our islands?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the bill, as it's been put forward and the proposals within that that are currently out to consultation, includes powers to enable us to continue to support beef and sheep farmers, and that includes those farming in our most marginal land. We know that grazing livestock is absolutely vital for food production, but we also know that it's vital for our biodiversity and for various habitats and species. So that's why we're committed to providing that support. But I would also like to take the opportunity in mentioning the Agriculture Bill consultation, that we will be extending that by another couple of weeks. So the consultation had been due to run until the 21st of November. It will now run until the 5th of December. And that's also specifically because we'll be holding an in-person consultation event in Kirkwall, I believe, on the 28th of November. But of course, I will be happy to circulate further information of those events.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions on rural affairs and islands. We will now turn to the next portfolio after a very short pause to allow frontbench teams to change position. Thank you. Thank you. The next portfolio is health and social care. If a member wishes to seek to ask a supplementary question, they should press the request to speak button during the relevant question or enter the letters RTS in the chat function during the relevant question. Again, I would ask for succinct questions and answers in order to get in as many members as possible. I call question number one, Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it's supporting the training of advanced clinical practitioners.
Cabinet Secretary Hamza Youssef.
Advanced clinical practitioner, in the broadest sense, is a term that can be applied in the context of a range of healthcare professionals. These practitioners are able to take on expanded roles as a consequence of advanced educational achievement, which is reflected in the scope of this practice. In Scotland, we now have an established advanced nursing practice education and training network that will be committed to training 500 additional advanced nurse practitioners by 2021, a target which was exceeded and made possible with £4 million Scottish Government funding to all regional NHS boards for trainee advanced nurse practitioners across all nursing fields and all settings, including acute community care homes and indeed in prisons too.
Gillian Martin.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. He has largely answered my supplementary question, and I just want to mention that I spoke to an ACP working in an A&E department who told me with the training of more ACPs, the burden on consultants would be significantly reduced and A&E waiting times improved. Is the Cabinet Secretary minded to look at developing this particular strand of training and recruitment with those things in mind?
Cabinet Secretary.
To continuing to invest in our advanced nurse practitioners and other advanced clinical practitioners. I was myself at A&E in Wishaw today and got to speak to an advanced nurse practitioner, and it was very clear from the excellent work that he was doing that that then freed up some time of, for example, some of the consultants, medical force and indeed other nursing staff to be able to look at other cases. So they are worth their weight in gold and more, I would suggest, and therefore we'll continue to make sure we invest in advanced nurse and indeed advanced clinical practitioners.
A supplementary from Carol Mochan, who is joining us online. Ms Mochan.
Thank you. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Training advanced clinical professionals is vital to ensuring the NHS develops and improves the level of care it provides. Allied health professionals from across Scotland, including many of the nearly 100 who were in this Parliament last month, are seeing the pressures facing specialised NHS staff on a daily basis. AHPs are our third largest workforce, and their skills can and will improve patients' outcomes. Will the Minister commit to listening to and working with AHPs to ensure they are supported and adequately resourced so that NHS service planning includes pathways for AHPs to further develop advanced clinical roles, ensuring clinical leadership from AHPs across the whole of health and social care?
Cabinet Secretary.
I agree with almost all of what Carol Mochan has to say. I think our AHPs play a tremendous role, whether it's in our acute settings or indeed within community. I'm committed to continuing to work with those professional bodies that represent our allied health professionals, continuing to invest in them, and where appropriate, absolutely making sure that we invest in their further education and training, because just as the point that Gillian Martin rightly made, we know that given the demands on the health service, the wider and broader way in which we can spread that workload, the better for everybody involved. So I agree very much with Karen Walker, and happy to discuss this further with her offline if she wishes.
Question number two, Jamie Green.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what additional strain excessive alcohol consumption is having on the NHS.
Minister Marie Todd.
Excess alcohol consumption is an important public health challenge in Scotland. It contributes to an increasing risk of developing a number of conditions, including cancers, heart disease and stroke. In 2020-21, there were 35,124 alcohol-related hospital admissions in Scotland. This was a decrease from previous years, although the COVID-19 and lockdown measures are likely to have contributed to this.
Jamie Green.
Can I thank the Minister for the statistical update? After I wrote an article recently in Holyrood magazine about my own very personal family experience of alcohol, a constituent wrote to me with some on-the-ground feedback about what's actually happening in alcohol services. She said, the lack of societal responsibility for our national shame is clearly demonstrated through a lack of coordination of services. And when there's no coordination, there is no responsibility. We should never have to beg to be cared for. It is humiliating, she said. Can I simply ask, why are so many people being let down at the moment by alcohol treatment services? Why are so many people not being treated? Why are so many people not being listened to? Because this experience shared by my constituent, I'm sure, is shared by thousands across Scotland, and it's simply not good enough.
Minister.
So alcohol and drug-related harms are vitally important public health issues in Scotland, and that's why we established a national mission to improve and save lives. And at the core of that mission is ensuring that every individual is able to access the treatment and the recovery that they choose. Now, we're working to ensure that people with alcohol use disorder continue to receive the same quality of care as those with problematic drug use do. The forthcoming alcohol treatment guidelines, which have been delayed multiple times, we're working with the UK government on those, will provide support for alcohol treatment similar to the medication-assisted treatment standards for drugs. And we're also developing alcohol treatment targets alongside stage two of the drugs target implementation in 2024. We're absolutely aware of the challenges facing the community in terms of accessing care. We're investing in residential rehabilitation. That will benefit people who are experiencing alcohol challenges as well as those with drug addiction. And alcohol absolutely remains a priority for the Scottish Government. Our alcohol and drugs teams work very closely together on these issues, sharing our knowledge around what works on ways to reduce the impact of addiction and as well as routes through treatment.
A supplementary, Paul O'Kane.
Presiding Officer, in the summer recess I visited Moving On Inverclyde, which is a community-based service supporting people who are in recovery from addiction and supporting families who've lost a loved one to alcohol or drugs, crucially often contributing to the reduction of strain on our NHS. Inverclyde is one of five local authorities where alcohol-specific death rates have consistently remained above the Scottish average for the last 5 years. And in response to those figures, Dr Alistair McGilchrist, Chair of the Scottish Health Action on Alcohol Problems, has called on the Scottish Government to increase funding and resources for alcohol services. So can I ask the Minister what additional support will be made available to ensure that people have access to life-changing and saving support so often delivered in the third sector, particularly given the challenges many charities are facing just to keep the lights on and the doors open with the cost of energy and resources?
Minister.
For me to say here is that every death from alcohol is an absolute tragedy. At the moment, we lose 24 people a week from direct alcohol-related deaths in Scotland. That is simply the tip of the iceberg, because behind those statistics of direct alcohol deaths, there are also a number of deaths where alcohol is a factor, where, you know, cardiac deaths and accidents and all sorts of other deaths, cancer as well being a big issue. We are absolutely investing in addiction services as a whole because of the National Drugs Mission. We are determined to improve the situation for people who are facing alcohol-related harms. As I said in my answer to the previous questioner, we are awaiting national treatment guidelines, which we're working on a four-nation basis. Once those are in place, we'll be able to develop targets and we'll be able to scrutinise what's happening on the ground and invest impactfully in areas where there are gaps to absolutely ensure that the situation improves, as well as the work to directly improve access to addiction care. We are working on a whole population basis to try to ensure that the long-standing and challenging relationship that we have with alcohol in Scotland is altered in future. One of the main flagship policies in that, minimum unit pricing of alcohol, this whole Parliament will be asked on whether we continue that, and if we do continue it, what price we should set it at, if we should review that cost. But there are a number of other policies in the pipeline, including alcohol advertising and a whole suite of policies which we are determined to use in order to tackle that long-standing blight on our national landscape.
Question number three, Fulton MacGregor.
Yeah, thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what support is in place for people with long COVID.
Cabinet Secretary.
All NHS boards are providing support for people with long COVID across local primary care teams, community-based rehabilitation services and referrals for further investigation in secondary care settings, of course, where clinically appropriate. For example, in September, I was pleased to meet the multidisciplinary team responsible for NHS Lanarkshire's long COVID rehabilitation pathway, which covers the member's constituency. This is delivering a single point of access for assessment and coordinated support from services including physiotherapy, occupational therapy, psychology, and speech and language therapy too, depending on what is, of course, most appropriate for the individual's needs.
Fulton MacGregor.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response and for his response to my recent written question on the matter, and I do welcome the development of the centre in Lanarkshire. Over the last few months, I've been dealing with a constituent, Tracy McMillan, who's been in touch about her son, Jonathan. I know that Tracy has also been in touch with the Cabinet Secretary direct. Jonathan is in his third year of suffering from long COVID and has been bedbound for over a year. And it really is such a tragic set of circumstances, as he should be attending his sixth year of high school, applying for university and having fun, but instead, he cannot get out of bed most of the time. His parents have found it extremely difficult to get any support through the NHS or to get a diagnosis. They found that primary caregivers have no one to refer him to, and the family have had to turn to private providers, where he has recently been diagnosed with mast cell activation syndrome, which is common in long COVID, and symptoms can hopefully be treated, but again, at a considerable cost. Can I therefore ask the Cabinet Secretary if the Government is undertaking any meaningful research into long COVID, and when will multidisciplinary teams of knowledgeable healthcare professionals be established to help people like Jonathan with diagnosis and medical intervention?
Cabinet Secretary.
To thank Fulton MacGregor for the question, for raising Jonathan's case here in Parliament. I have met Tracy in June, and Fulton MacGregor's constituent, and I know from speaking to her just how challenging the symptoms are and what a detrimental impact and effect they're having on her son, Jonathan. I've also written to Jonathan. My understanding is that he has been offered NHS support through the pathway that I referred to in my previous answer to Fulton MacGregor. In terms of the specific question on mast cell activation syndrome and research, Scottish Government has worked with a range of specialists, including immunologists, to develop an implementation support note that provides practical information for clinicians on the identification, assessment and management of the long-term effects of COVID-19. This includes information on mast cell activation syndrome. We have funded nine Scottish-led research projects on the long-term effects of COVID-19 with a total funding commitment of £2.5 million. These studies, of course, aim to improve our understanding of the long-term effects of COVID-19 on physical and mental health in Scotland, and inform the clinical interventions to support recovery and rehabilitation. While none of the projects focus specifically on mast cell activation syndrome, our Chief Scientist Office research funding schemes are open, and applications on this syndrome are indeed welcome. Applications would go through the CSO's standard independent expert review process to allow funding decisions to be made.
And supplementary, Sanjesh Gohani.
Thank you. In October 21, 90,000 Scots were suffering with long COVID. In May 22, the Scottish Government announced £3 million from its long COVID fund to be allocated in 2022. The number of Scots with long COVID is now 200,000. That's more than the population of Aberdeen. My question is, how much of this £3 million has been allocated, and specifically for what purposes? And does the Cabinet Secretary accept the number of long COVID cases in Scotland to continue to balloon like over the 12 months previously?
Cabinet Secretary.
In terms of the specifics, I will write to Dr. Sandesh Gulhani with the detail not only of how much has been allocated, but how much has been allocated per health board, if you would find that useful. And indeed, we can give him some detail of each of those projects as well. And he'll know, of course, that's a £10 million commitment over three financial years. But I think the important point to make here is that, yes, there's no doubt that there's been a rise in those who are suffering the long-term effects of COVID. We've seen that in the Scottish Health Survey. We've seen that in the ONS survey data that comes forward too. And therefore, I would expect health boards to readjust their spending in light of where there are additional demands. He will know, of course, that there is exceptional pressure on our health budget. In fact, my health budget is worth £650 million less than when it was set in December, just down to inflationary pressures. So, of course, these are difficult financial circumstances, but where we have an increase in demand, as we have seen with long COVID, I would expect health boards to adjust their spending appropriately.
A supplementary, Jackie Bailey.
Long COVID Scotland published a harrowing report last week revealing that only one person out of the hundreds that replied had actually fully recovered, and relapses were common in 4 out of 5 experiencing symptoms. These aren't just statistics. We're talking about our friends, our families, our neighbours. Let me come back to money, because when you announced the £3 million for long COVID services, 79,000 people were diagnosed with long COVID. According to the ONS, a year later, that has increased to 202,000 people, a staggering 155% increase. So rather than leave cash-strapped health boards to pick up the slack, is the Cabinet Secretary going to increase the budget to meet that significant additional demand?
Cabinet Secretary.
As I've said to Dr. Sandesh Gulhani in my previous answer, of course, wherever there are demands or increases in demands, we expect health boards to readjust their spending accordingly. We would expect them to do so. What I would say to Jackie Bailey, and I think she's quite aware of this, is that I have had to reprofile £400 million worth of funding in order to make sure that we deal with the inflationary pressures that have impacted on our budget, and also to make sure that our NHS staff get a fair pay deal. Now, she has stood up, I think, in this chamber, certainly publicly, she's criticised some of that reprofiling for mental health, social care, primary care, all really, really difficult decisions, not ones that I took any pleasure in making or taking, but having to do so because we live within a finite budget. So if Ms Bailey has an idea of where else we should reprofile money for to put it into, for example, long COVID, then of course I'm more than happy to have that discussion with her off table.
Question number 4, Alex Riley.
Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government, in light of the reported present staffing crisis, how will it adequately staff for the proposed national treatment centres?
Cabinet Secretary.
We are committed to recruiting 1,500 additional staff in this Parliament to work across our national treatment centres. The Scottish Government is providing a range of recruitment support, training and development activity to assist health boards with securing the right mix of new and experienced staff. This includes additional funding to support international recruitment, provide additional postgraduate speciality training places in medicine, funding training opportunities through the NHS Academy, including training for new perioperative staff, and actively considering future staffing needs as part of that ongoing workforce planning activity. We've also taken action to support retention of experienced staff and to develop new pathways into NHS Scotland careers.
Ali Shirley.
Excuse me.
Presiding Officer, the Cabinet Secretary says they are committed to putting 1,500 additional staff in. You might want to see how that's going. Can you also set out a timetable? In recent weeks and months, I have met with staff at a local level in Fife and across the region. I've met with local trade unions, and they ask this question. So is there not also a need for greater transparency? Whilst people acknowledge the difficulties that have happened and the NHS is under, they have to have confidence that the government's on top of this. And if the very staff that are working on the front line don't have that confidence, then how can you expect anyone else to have it?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I speak to staff regularly. In fact, was doing so today during a visit to Lanarkshire, to Wishaw, as A&E department. And what I would say to Alex Riley is this government's got a really proud record in terms of our NHS staffing and growing that staffing, of course. We have NHS staffing at record levels. What we have committed to do next year is when it comes to our regular stats. We will publish the detail of how the recruitment is going for the NTCs. I will again just state that commitment that we are talking about 1,500 additional staff for our national treatment centres. In terms of the information that I have to hand, I can say from my discussions with the local health board that the recruitment for the Fife National Treatment Centre is going well and very much on track for its opening next year.
Supplementary, Sue Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The 10 national treatment centres should deliver at least 40,000 additional elective surgeries and procedures a year by 2026. Luke Farrow, an orthopaedic surgeon and research fellow at the University of Aberdeen, told BBC Scotland that getting the treatment centres online is an absolute priority. Every week, the backlog gets worse. Mr Farrow also stated that there must be planning to ensure that the 1,500 staff for the national treatment centres are not taken from elsewhere in the NHS, which would merely serve to worsen wider recruitment issues. The treatment centre in Livingston for NHS Lothian will need 400 staff, but NHS Lothian have warned there are significant risks and challenges around this level of hiring. Can the Cabinet Secretary confirm that none of the 1,500 staff required for the national treatment centres will be taken from within the current NHS staff?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I say that, again, just reiterate what I said to Alex earlier, that we expect the 1,500 staff to be additional staff. It's worth noting the commitment to recruit 1,500 additional staff equates to less than 1% of the total NHS workforce. The risk of destabilisation are therefore slim, although, of course, we will engage with boards, like we would do with Lothian, in order to monitor any local challenges. And there are challenges. There are areas when we look at the recruitment of staff where there are significant challenges, not just in urban settings like our NTC in Edinburgh, but of course in our remote and rural communities in particular. So we'll have that regular engagement, but I think it would be, I can give a firm commitment that one, we are talking about additional staff, but secondly, the risk of destabilisation, I think, is very slim indeed.
Supplementary, Willie Rennie.
Boasting about recruitment track records and talking about the current crisis as being a challenge, I think, underestimates the real crisis that we've got in our NHS. Just this week, we've heard about the astonishing waits at A&Es. Just this week, we've heard about the crisis in our mental health services. But yet the Minister talks as if he's managing the system well. When is he going to get real about the crisis in the NHS? When is he going to sort it out?
Cabinet Secretary.
See, that was another Willie Rennie intervention, full of constructive ideas, solutions and suggestions. And what I would say to Willie Rennie is nobody underestimates, not me and the government, nobody underestimates the challenge that the NHS is under. That's why I spend every single waking moment trying to do our best to resolve some of the issues that we're facing, not just in the NHS, but also in social care. That's why the government has invested record funding into our NHS and social care. It's why we have record staffing in our NHS. That is not a boast. That is simply to demonstrate that we are taking action in order to help our NHS at the period of really difficulty, real challenge, and that challenge is only going to increase, we know, over the course of winter. But if Willie Rennie does have any constructive suggestions in terms, and he's shaking his head to say no, he doesn't, but if he does, I'm more than happy to sit down with him and have that discussion off table.
And supplementary, Stephanie Callaghan.
Presiding Officer, in light of Keir Starmer's truly irresponsible comments on reducing migrant workers in the NHS, how can the Scottish Government ensure that Scotland attracts the finest talent from overseas to address the immediate staffing shortages in our health service?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I would agree with Stephanie Callaghan. I thought Keir Starmer's comments on overseas workers was inflammatory. I think it has no place in Scotland. Our NHS families should be proud of the fact that it's diverse. We have people from all across the world who choose to work within our NHS. They come here and they provide excellent care to those in need, whether they're nurses, doctors, cleaners, admin staff, porters and anybody in between, whatever your role, whether you've been in Scotland for 20 years or for just a couple of weeks, not only is Scotland your home, but you are, we are proud to have you as part of the NHS family. And the Labour Party, instead of chuntering from the sidelines, they should care less about the front pages of certain right-wing newspapers and do like we do in the Scottish Government and care more about the front line of our NHS.
Question number 8, Sharon Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it can provide an update on the steps it's taking to encourage more GPs to work in rural practices.
Cabinet Secretary.
We are fully committed to ensuring that all communities in Scotland receive safe, reliable and sustainable healthcare services, including, of course, in general practice. The Scottish Government does offer a wide range of initiatives specifically to attract GPs to rural areas. These include golden hellos and bursaries for newly qualified GPs to take up posts in hard-to-fill rural locations. I would add that our new ScotGem programme, our graduate entry medicine programme, focuses on general practice, and rural working is proving very, very popular. It had its first cohort of 44 students graduating earlier in June of this year from Dundee and St Andrews Universities.
Sharon Dowie.
Current recruitment strategies are clearly not working. In the rural area I represent, GP practices have had to close as they were unable to recruit more GPs. Other practices have stepped in, but they too are struggling due to recruitment issues and are having to rely on expensive locum GPs. This situation is replicated across rural areas throughout Scotland. Yep. I want to ask the Cabinet Secretary not to repeat previous answers, as we need something different.
Indeed.
What more is the Scottish Government doing now to address rural GP recruitment issues? What incentives are there for doctors to specialise in general practice? And how many additional places will be made available at Scottish universities to help fill future vacancies?
Well, what I would say to Sharon Dowie is that we have a commitment in our manifesto to increase medical graduate places by 100 per year, and we're fulfilling that commitment. So there is something very tangible we're doing, but it's so important, of course, that we're also able to then ensure that a percentage of those individuals graduating end up in general practice. Our GP ST bursary is, of course, a phenomenal and has been a phenomenal success. It's contributing towards 800 more GPs in Scotland, that target we've set between 2017 and 2027, in an effort to make GP training a more attractive career option. Scotland offers a one-off taxable bursary of £20,000 for GP STs, and the criteria being posts in locations that are historically hard to fill. Notwithstanding that, and what I've already said in terms of what we're doing, I do recognise the points that Sharon Dowie and others have made. So we are very actively and proactively looking to recruit from other parts of the UK. She may well have seen that we have a marketing campaign where we are marketing Scotland as an attractive destination to work for GPs and other medical staff to come to Scotland to set up a life here and to work here. And in fact, in the latest round of that marketing campaign, I know our team attended the joint RCGP Wonka Europe event held at the Excel Arena in London, and they made over 80 contacts with delegates who shared with them a desire to come and work here in Scotland, either now or in the future. So we are straining every sinew possible. We have a number of incentivisation programmes in place, but it will be hard graft and hard work that I'm convinced that we can continue to do that will ensure that we have as many GPs coming to train here, to work here, build a family here, and I'm happy if there are specific instances that any members wish me to look at, that I'm happy to do so.
And I can squeeze in two supplementaries if they're very brief, with brief answers. Supplementary, Beatrice Wishart.
It's not just rural areas struggling to fill vacancies, but also island posts. What can the Cabinet Secretary say to a local doctor promoting a GP role in the community of Hillswick when a BMA Scotland survey finding that there's nearly 50% of junior doctors are considering leaving the profession, and squaring that with the 2007 SNP manifesto commitment to encourage people to train in rural medicine and commit to working in rural areas?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think it's important that we don't lose sight of the impact, I'm afraid, interventions like Brexit have had. And I know that's particularly relevant to islands such as Shetland, where I know quite a considerable number of doctors and medical staff were from Europe. Notwithstanding that, of course, because that is being taken forward full scale by the UK government, I won't reiterate and repeat what I have already said in relation to the incentivisation schemes that we have in place, but I'm happy to discuss these issues with Beatrice Wishart if she thinks there's more that we can do, particularly for our island communities. But my dialogue with Shetland, with Orkney, with our colleagues in Western Isles, and indeed the Highlands and Islands, is one that continues with regularity.
A supplementary briefly, Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the steps that are being taken so far but can the Cabinet Secretary expand on the challenges faced in recruiting GPs from overseas, which, if overcome, could help with the GP numbers within rural areas and the Highlands and Islands?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think it's an important question from Jackie Dunbar. It's a source of quite constant frustration, I think, for most government ministers that the immigration system that the UK government currently has just does not meet the needs, neither of those living here in Scotland, but I suspect is doing damage to the profession in England as well as the wider UK too. I have raised the issue and intend to do so again around the Home Office immigration rules. We know that they have particular issues in relation to Tier 2 visas. That's impacting on international medical graduates working in the UK post-GP training. They're often left in a position of potentially being in the country illegally if they can't find a sponsor within a few weeks of completing their training, and they're unable to apply for indefinite leave to remain. Something has to change. I will be writing and intervening again on this issue with the Home Office, seeking a meeting on this important issue. And while the Scottish Government will continue to press the UK Government on these issues at every available opportunity, my officials are also working with stakeholders to pull together some of the best practice guidance to assist practices who wish to become sponsors to enable these highly skilled professionals to continue their careers in the NHS in Scotland.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions on health and social care. There will be a very short pause before we move on to the next item of business. Thank you.